I'll wait till Reshmi finishes her phone call. Welcome, everyone. This afternoon, the university is paying a tribute to V K Murthy, who doesn't need an introduction to this audience, I hope. It won't be inappropriate to start with a note of regret that we had been meaning to have him over for a lecture. And then became more ambitious and thought we should do an extended 2-day discussion of his craft, inviting leading technicians from different cities, which never happened. And then we saw this news that he passed away. And since then, we've been meaning to have a tribute to him, and it's happening this afternoon. Our panelists this afternoon are Umara, who's a biographer of V K Murthy, and a very well-reputed Kannada short story writer and columnist. And G.S. Bhaskar is our second panelist, who is a distinguished cinematographer. Two of his recent films were Kurmavatara with Girish Kasaravalli, and Ijjodu that he did with M.S. Satyu. Before they speak, we'll have a screening of a 29-minute tribute that Govind Nihalani made for V.K. Murthy at the time of the release of the biography in 2006. Before that happens, I would like to invite Anurag Bihar, the Vice Chancellor, to say a few words, because truly he is behind this event. It is at his insistence that we have organized this, and it's only appropriate that he say a few things about why V K Murthy matters to him so much. Thanks.
So good afternoon. You know, this is too formal. You can't do it this way, isn't it? Sorry? Sing a song. Vakt ne kiya. Okay. So,
you know, I think in 2010, when did Mr. Murthy receive the Dadasaheb Phalke Award?
2010.
So I think 2010, I think it was an evening when I, as usual, was browsing, and I saw that the Dadasaheb Phalke Award had been announced, and Mr. Murthy had been bestowed that honor. So I must say that that is one turning point in my mind about the nature of awards, meaning in the sense that it brought back some respectability to the notion of an award. Right? I don't know whether I'm able to communicate what I'm saying, right? So, I mean, a man like Mr. Murthy, who was, his legendary simplicity and accessibility, I only had the privilege of hearing. Never could I meet him, that's one of my regrets. But a man of that nature, that the Dadasaheb Phalke Award should go to, it should have gone to him maybe 15, 20, 25 years ago. But that it did, so there's some respectability to the award. You know, the nature of his contribution to India, not just Indian cinema, is, to my mind, totally staggering. I mean, I cannot think of any field of human endeavor where you can think of somebody who will be behind the kind of milestones that he was behind in their own individual field of activity. So if you were to start from Bazi, where he was perhaps the assistant cinematographer?
Bazi.
Bazi was the assistant cinematographer, that's the first time, right? And then, from then on, Jal was his first movie. So after Jal, going through, you know, Aar Paar, Pyaasa, and but the problem is, and that's why I said, what a staggering contribution. Which is, then you think that it's also Pakeezah, right? And Razia Sultan, right? And I don't have a very high opinion of Razia Sultan, the movie itself, but but it doesn't stop there. Can you believe it that it is also Bharat, Khoj?
Right? So, I mean, if you were to think of the staggering nature of this man's achievement and contribution, I mean, it is like saying that there was a temple architect who built Khajuraho and built Belur Halibed and built Bredeshwara in Tanjavur and built, by the way, the Mount Abu Dilwara temples. That is the kind of contribution this man has had to this country. So absolutely staggering.
Like I said, it is my eternal regret that I could not meet him. Chandan and I kept talking about it, and our, like he said, our ambition just kept growing. First we said we'll invite him for a colloquium. Then we said, oh no, no, why a colloquium? And by then I think he had got onto this thing about the, he was recording the year of Anantamurthy interviews. So we said, you know, if you're doing it with Anantamurthy, why don't you do it with Mr. Murthy also? So our ambition just kept growing. And we just made an absolutely irredeemable error by not inviting him here. One of my earliest memories, and I never knew it was Mr. Murthy behind that, is, you know, all of us, I mean, you know, you say Mr. Murthy and Bhakt ne kiya ki Aasi Sitam is invoked, right? Ordinarily. But to me, somehow I was always fascinated by that one scene, and I don't know, some of you would not even be familiar with the scene. That's in Jal, right? In Jal, when Devananda is singing that song, which one? I can quiz you.
Ye Raat Ye Chandni.
Ye Raat Ye Chandni. I mean, I think this is an extraordinary shot. I had never seen anything like that. And I'm talking about the late 70s or 80s when I saw it for the first time. I had never seen anything like that. And after that, of course, it was one scene after another. Absolutely magical. So, thank you for both of you for being here. It's our privilege that you're here. Both of you have met, talked, worked with Mr. Murthy. Thank you. And hope we can do something year after year in his memory. Okay, thanks.
Namaskara. ನಮಸ್ಕಾರ ಇವತ್ತು ವಿ ಕೆ ಮೂರ್ತಿಯವರು ಇದ್ದಿದ್ರು ಆ್ಯಕ್ಚುಲಿ ಇದು ನೋಡಿದ ತಕ್ಷಣ ಮಾತಾಡೋದು ಭಾಳ ಕಷ್ಟ ಆಗ್ತಿದೆ ಐ ಬಿಕಮ್ ವೆರಿ ಓ ಸಾರಿ ಯಾ ಐ ಬಿಕಮ್ ಸೋ ಇಮೋಷ್ನಲ್ ಐ ವಾಸ್ ಟ್ರೈಂಗ್ ಟು ಸೇ ಇಟ್ಸ್ ವೆರಿ ಡಿಫಿಕಲ್ಟ್ ಟು ಸ್ಪೀಕ್ ಇಮಿಡಿಯೇಟ್ಲಿ ಆಫ್ಟರ್ ವಾಚಿಂಗ್ ದಟ್ ಫಿಲ್ಮ್ ಸೊ ಐ ಫರ್ಗಾಟ್ ದಟ್ ಐ ಹ್ಯಾಡ್ ಟು ಸ್ಪೀಕ್ ಹಿಯರ್ ಇನ್ ಇಂಗ್ಲೀಷ್ ಸೊ ನವೆಂಬರ್ 26th is V.K. Murthy's birthday. So I am very glad that I got this opportunity to share a few glimpses of his life today here as a birth anniversary tribute to him. And I would like to thank Azim Premji University for giving me this opportunity to do so. See, there may be many people here, I don't know, who haven't seen his films or maybe who were not even born when he shifted from Mumbai to Bangalore. So for the uninitiated, I would like to give a brief list of the films he made. And see, beginning with the films he made with Guru Dutt, that was a number of delightful films which were different in theme, imagery, content, and they were path-breaking. And these films culminated finally in the big three, that is Pyaasa, Kaagaz ke Phool, and Sahib Bibi or Gulam. As you know, these two had a great synergy, and also they shared a common vision. So they could create, V.K. Murthy in Guru Dutt's direction could, whatever he created was sheer poetry on screen. So who can forget that scene in Pyaasa where Guru Dutt stands against the light in a dimly lit auditorium, or the beam scene in Kaagaz ke Phool, which was the first film in India to be shot in cinemascope. And the other one that comes to my mind is the Qawwali scene in Sahib Bibi Gulam, where the play of shadow and lights actually creates a mesmerizing effect. And the song Najao Sanya, which is entirely shot in close-ups, is so intensely emotional. So all this happened because Murthy took risks, he experimented, innovated. And the lights and shadows he gave, that gave a rare depth and three-dimensional quality to his imagery, which resulted in great emotional impact. And then after Gurudev's death, he told me that I felt my career was over. I wouldn't be able to do anything, because all this was possible, because Guru Dutt was very, we worked together, and he gave me a lot of freedom to do whatever I wanted. Now, I don't think I'll find a director like that. So he said, I cried. I thought my life was over. But then came a phase, he started working in color films. That was with Pramod Chakravarti. And even there, he created magic, because he again experimented and he shot in low light and did things which so far nobody else did. So then came a series of commercial blockbusters like Love in Tokyo, Ziddi, Naya Zamana, and all. For the incredible work he did, he got recognition, he got awards, he got many Filmfare awards, that Kodak Award for Lifetime Achievement Mami, and International Award IFA, and finally the Dadasaheb Phalke Award for the highest achievement in Indian cinema. And in addition, he also got the Karnataka Rajyotsava Award and the Natak Academy Award for his contribution to theater. That anybody don't know how much he has contributed to theater. And Pyaasa was listed as one of the best 100 movies of the century in Time magazine, last century. So now I would like to move on to, after I have given you a brief introduction of this, I would like to move on to how I met this person. See, I met Kutti. I say Kutti because that's what he was. He was Kutti to us, the family, friends, everybody in Mumbai, Mysore Association members, all of us called him Kutti. Only in the Bollywood, he was known as Murthy sir. Otherwise, for all of us, he was Kutti, and for youngsters, he was Kutti Mama. Kutti Mama was very great, very big, because he took us to see shooting. Whoever came from Bangalore or Mysore or any place, then he would immediately take us to see shooting. So when I met Kutti, I was 13. I had gone to Mumbai to just see Mumbai, and then it so used to be there.
And the thing was that he was very fond of two things at that time. He was working with Guru Dutt. And that time Guru Dutt's studios used to work like an office. He says like 9 to 5. That was the earlier film days. And they would have free time in the evening. Evening he would come directly to the Mysore Association. Then he would take part in the first they would chit chat. And he started a lot of activities in the Mysore Association fine arts. He was a very good violin player. So he conducted orchestras and directed plays. And theater was his favorite. So whenever we went to Mysore Association, we used to go to see his plays. And his favorite, he wrote and directed plays. And was that he was very fond of detective thriller plays or humorous plays, and he was very his big favorite was Kailasa. And even now people say nobody can direct Kailasa's plays like Murthy, because he could really break the dialogue, which is very difficult to say now, which they say only old Mysoreans can. I don't know. So he was very, he was an expert in that. So that time we used to meet Murthy whenever we went to Satyadev Dubey's place in Prithvi, or Motley in Chavindas, or Vijay Tendulkar in NCPA, Murthy would be there to watch the place. Now coming back to his, now I should come back to, yeah, this, he shifted to Bangalore, and after a few days he shifted to Bangalore. And I read an interview in because that time he was such a non-filmy person. When we met him in the association, none of us felt that he was from films, he was from Bollywood, that we wouldn't be able to talk to him or anything. It somehow didn't occur to us also, though he was already had got so many awards. It's not that he was already doing his best work with Guru Dutt. But still for us he was only good, he was very friendly and a great friend of ours. And then when I came to Bangalore, I read an article that was an interview by a girl who had asked V K Murthy, sir, you have done such great work, why is it that anyone, your life is very interesting, why is it you haven't written your autobiography? Then he laughed and said, you must remember that I am only a cameraman, I am not a writer, I can't write. So suddenly it occurred to me, what was I doing here? Because I had done a couple of interviews in Mumbai. That was a different thing for some magazines in Canada. But being a writer and having such a genius, who is a close friend, who definitely, even if he was a little reserved and he would not easily open up, he would definitely agree to talk to me. And next morning I went to his place. And when I went to his place and I told him, I have come here, I want to write your biography. Then he laughed and said, what is the greatness, the great things have I achieved for you to write my biography? Then I said, don't say all that, I want to write it, so please stop. He said, okay, if you want to go ahead and make me great, he said, go ahead. Used to sit and chat about this. Always Sandhya would send us a hot cup of coffee first. Sandhya, his wife, was also very active with the Mysore Association. Always she also acted, that is, they were always together. So then the first day, I remember the first thing for the book he said was that, Uma, I lost my mother when I was very young. That made a lot of emotional impact on me. He said, I was just 8 when I lost my mother. I was out coming from school, after coming back from school as pain. And somebody called me back home. I saw people were crying and my mother was no more. And things happened so fast that my baby sisters were taken away by my aunt to be brought up in Chittamani. And we were left, my father, my brother and I. And from that day, the whole life changed. Of course, he was very sad in the beginning when he says he was crying in the evenings. Because his father was a Ayurveda Pandit and he would go to the dispensary in the morning. From there, he would go to some temples, chat with friends and come back at 8:30. And his brother would also go out playing. And he found he felt very, very lonely staying at home. And that time, one of his cousins came and asked him, why don't you come with me? There is a theater here, Krishna Talkies, close by. There they screen silent movies. This friend was Subramanian, who was his cousin. He sees silent movies, he says, used to be projected, and there used to be an orchestra which used to play background music, got into the scene. They would be practicing, watching the movie one or two times, and whatever they felt like, well, there was a group of boys who would play that, actually, after that. And then the automatic, every movie, they would only compose their tunes and they would play. So it was like that. So this Subramanian used to play harmony. Then Kutti started going there with him. And then he says, see, that time Uma people were very good. The Krishna Shetty, owner of the darkest one, said, oh, poor boy, you have lost your mother also, you are so alone. You can come and watch the movie every day. I won't charge you, you don't have to buy tickets. So then he started going there. Actually, he says as soon as he entered that theater, his whole world would change. He would enter into the magical imagery, the songs, everything. So I think that's the time all this got into his system. This music, this love for music, this love for imagery. But what happened was that after a year, this suddenly silent film era came to an end. And the talkies came. So then actually he says the biggest hit was taken by the orchestra people because they all became jobless. So this theater owners, though, they were kind enough to give them some jobs like office assistants, ticket collectors. And he said some of the Brahmins, they gave ticket collectors a job in the balcony. Little comments like that, no? It has such a, actually it used to make such a social comment also, that's what people would make such small comments, you know. So either they used to, but they were very good. And another love of his was music. Music, actually, there was a boy in his class who used to learn violin very close to his place. And whenever they learned violin, the mood would go and sit there. But the thing is that he didn't have money to buy a violin or not attend the class. Then he went and asked his father, can you buy a violin for me? The father agreed and he bought a second-hand violin for 3 rupees. He said, I don't know whether it was good or bad, there was a Bengali shop somewhere in Mysore market. So there we got it. And I would go and sit there and listen and come back home and practice myself. That's how the love of music developed, and later on he was a brilliant violin player. Actually, many people don't know that he was a brilliant violin player too. And after this, now I also remember, Bhaskar also remembers, on his 90th birthday, then we went to Vishin, you know, we used to go to Vishin. We had requested him, please, for once you should play violin for us. So he had put it somewhere on that, he put it down, tuned it, and that day I still remember he had played it for us. So run away to Mumbai because he saw an advertisement of some Prabhat studios running a training course in film cinematography. So without he collected money somehow and ran away, and then after going there, he saw that there was a totally bogus institute, there was nothing. And he stayed in there in a friend's place for some time, his uncle was there. And then he came back, he said, I was very ashamed to go and show my face to everybody because everybody would make fun of me. He went and did nothing. So then he, when he was in this, Jayachamarajendra Polytechnic, which was started by M. Visheshwaraya, we started cinematography classes began. So that was the time he felt very happy. He came and applied. He got a seat, but again, no money to pay the fees. He didn't know where to stay because he didn't have money for board and lodging. Finally, one of his friends said, you can stay in my room. And Ramkrishna boarding and lodging said, you can eat here, you don't have to pay. And one of his friends paid that 60 rupees, which was a month's salary for him, for what he does in accounting. Once he joined that, he was in his elements and he completed that, and then he went to Mumbai. But again, he emphasizes that after he went to Mumbai and some people introduced him to these famous studios and all, his first earning was again from music. He didn't get a cinematographer's job immediately, or an assistant cameraman's job. But there was he used to play harmonium and violin, and somebody said, "Arey, you play very well, why don't you play for the orchestra?" That time the orchestra used to record for film songs. So that time he got 75 rupees, that was his first earning in Mumbai. So he says music was all the way with me, even before films came. Then of course, whatever happened, that Bhaskar will tell you about how he got into films and how he got recognition, how he proceeded and all that. I will come back to Whistle Kodu. When I started writing Whistle Kodu, see, I thought I had this man who had seen films from silent era to 21st century, and then debris camera to digital. He remembers there was a debris camera in Pune which used to look like a box, and it used to be covered and you never knew where the box was from. It was like that. So from debris to digital era, and from almost no technology to the high tech era. And he had traveled all that, and also he had seen the society change. He had seen the status of women change. He had seen the status of junior artists change. I wanted all that to come from him, whatever happened. So then he started, by then he became very comfortable. Of course, there were places where there were things, he said, were very private or hurt somebody, because he never liked to hurt anybody. He would tell him, please switch off the recorder, this is only for you, I don't want you to write it. I agreed with that. And then he would go on. So I wanted to probe his life in its entirety. Whatever he has said, as I said about the thing, he was very sympathetic to women artists. He told me once that, see, when everything was ready, shot was ready to be taken, when the heroine was to be called, they used to say Chokri Kokula. They never took the name. So he said, why is that so? Why do they say Chokri Kokula? Arey Baba, you call her by her name, she is a star. So that was the status, you can imagine, in small comments what he can. So from that day, so of course, heroines are going to the cinema world, no? Where he has seen all, he has done it all. So I, then after that, he told me the whole story of his life. I gathered and I put things together and put it down. And then I spoke to his friends, his assistants, now many of whom have become very famous, like Govind, Nihalani, Bibi, Shirish Desai, and others. And also I spoke to people like Mahida Rahman, Shyam, again Govind, Nihalani, and all these people who worked with him, KJ Prabhakar, and all these people. And so that I get a perspective of him through their eyes out. So I must tell you that when I wrote this proposal, I got this thing which was so bomb, but it was so modest. I still, because I was struggling to understand the language of cinema, language of cinematography. Once I asked him, what is anamorphic format? What is cinemascope? How is it different? Then he sat with me for 2 hours, and like a child, he explained to me what it was. I'll never forget that. Like that, he used to explain to me all the technical things. So that's how I could come out with this book. Of course, my friends were there, including Bhaskar. If I had any problem, I would like to trouble Kutti, I would go to him, ask him, what is this, and all. And I always wonder with that limited technology, he says, I never said no. Guru Dutt asked me something, yes. I thought it was possible, nothing was impossible. And so he created wonders. And this journey with him was so enriching that I feel thankful that I got a chance to go through that. And now to give a perspective of what people who work with him feel about him, I will read a couple of excerpts of what they have said before reading my book. See, this is Govind speaking. When I requested Murthy sir to work for Tamas, these are all the excerpts from my biography, I have translated to English. When I requested Murthy sir to work for Tamas, he graciously agreed. The presence of Murthy sir on the sets itself makes such a huge difference. First, he is such a senior, highly respected person. And his attitude towards people and projects is so positive that everybody feels very secure and very respectful. So there is an amount of discipline that comes on the sets with his entry itself, and he is such a friendly sort. He is a difficult person to work with. In the sense, he gets very irritated if you don't do things right, but his attitude is positive. If you have a problem, he will explain to you patiently what is wrong. And Nihalani, talking about Murthy Sahib Bibi, said it was synergy between the director and the cameraman that created the breakthrough in imagery in the cinematic field. It was a tremendous movement forward as far as the art of imagery in Indian cinematography was concerned. That is why I got Pyaasa a landmark. But there was a bigger landmark awaiting there, Dadasaheb. It is even more sophisticated. Here there is a combination of realism and a certain kind of imaginative photography, where even techniques from theatre were borrowed and utilized in cinema in a manner in which it had never been attempted earlier. Even today, we rarely see things like that attempted. Here you see in the song sequence of Bhaktanekya, for the first time, a beautiful leading lady in Hindi cinema, Mahinda Rahman, looking lit from a light from below. It was considered so unflattering for a beautiful woman to be lit that way. Here, Murthy sir had the guts to say, yes, this is what it looks like, really in that situation. That created such a sensation that everybody became aware of kinds of possibilities in cinematic imagery. What Murthy did with Pyaasa and Kaagaz was to open the doors of possibilities. And another one is a hilarious one from Shirish Desai, who was the last but youngest person who trained as an assistant. Murthy sir had taught me everything about being a cameraman without saying it in words. Murthy sir and Shami Kapoor were great friends. Shami Kapoor was a very sensitive person. Once I was shooting with Shami Kapoor, in the middle of the shot, he commented that the look was wrong. I did not think so. A big argument followed, but I did not give it. Finally, he asked me, who had tried it? I said, V K Murthy. He laughed. No wonder they have such an attitude. Murthy sir had taught me how to stick to a decision if you are convinced about it. And Wahida Rahman, when she was talking to me, she says, I was lucky to have Murthy sir for my debut in Hindi. First of all, I never considered myself beautiful. So when I saw myself on the screen, I said, wow, I don't look bad. Murthy sir is very caring. I was shooting for Kaagaz for Navkeetu with Devanand and Vijayanand. He came on the set since he was also shooting in the same studios. He told Vijayanand, see that she is comfortable and gets her tea at 4. She will never ask, she will quietly suffer, take care of her. So sweet. Then Shyam Benegal had already told me the reason for him taking Murthy sir for Discovery of India, that is Bharat. He said this was an epic. This was 53 episodes, 1 hour each. and I wanted to do it for 19 months at one go without a break. And I wanted a perfect, excellent cameraman, not somebody who is just good. And when I thought of that, I couldn't think of anybody else but Pakeezah. But I also knew that he was 67 at that time. When I agreed, he agreed happily, and he was one person who never took a break for 19 months, except on Sundays. So that was his commitment, that was his excellence. And he says whenever, one more example, we did several extraordinary shoots for the Bharat Khoj. I particularly remember some of his camera operations for the work done for the Mahabharat episode. It was a trolley shot, Krishna's speech, that lasts unbroken for 9 minutes. A 1,000-foot roll has about 11 minutes of stop. Even if you make one mistake, it comes to changing the entire roll. Since I had chosen to do it in one shot, it meant Murthy's operations had to be perfect. The actors had to be perfect. The lighting had to be perfect. We did it. And it was on film. Today you can do it on video, but it was film. And we did it with very little wasting. Actually, Shyam says, whatever Murthy, whenever he delivered the negatives, they were so perfect that it could directly go to the lab for processing. I haven't seen anybody like that. So these are some perspectives from Murthy, from Visindu Guru. Now, again, remembering him fondly, I thank you all for being patient and listening to this. And thanks again for having me here.
Pranams to Azim Premji University and to our dear VC and to Mr. Chandan Kauda for making this afternoon possible and for enabling me to pay tribute to the great master V K Murthy during the week of his coming birthday. Before I proceed, I would like to share with you that during the forthcoming Bangalore Film Festival from December 4th to 11th, a tribute to V.K. Murthy is being planned. And on the 5th, there will be a master class with Govind and Nihalani at Chandrasekhar Studios on the Cunningham Road. Those of you who are interested, please join us there. And it's an open forum, but you'll have to register on there. Kindly share it with whosoever is interested. It's open for everybody. It's very difficult to talk about the work of a master that we can move in a few minutes or hours. Because his body of work is so huge, his contribution to Indian cinema is so big. That it would be absolutely injustice to kind of what he has achieved in his life. But I think VC set the tone right for this afternoon session. And he said that he brought back respectability to a national award. I think that was the right way to put it. And in fact, when he said that he should have come to him 15 years ago, 20 years ago. It was a general sentiment shared by everybody in the industry, not only in the industry, even in the ministry. And Sandhikaswami was the information minister at that time. During the presentation, she just came over to VK and said, "There are you taking Durustai." That's what she had to say herself. So that's the kind of thing that he commanded, kind of respected. Why is V.K. Murthy so important to Indian cinema? Thank you, Chandan, for making the job easier by putting the question. So, I'll try to make it very succinct. See, till V.K. Murthy happened, Indian cinema was by and large influenced by Hollywood. Our basic learning happened from Germany. Germany. Most of the German technicians came to India. And the Bombay Talkies was having a German technician as the chief of cameraman in the company. And most of us, we learned our basic craft from London and Germany. So we are following the European pattern. And after the World War, then we started following the Hollywood pattern, which was the key figures in that time were Hollywood history, Pardon Irani, and Dwarka Village. This is the point of time when V.K. Murthy made his entry into the field. We should understand the basic difference between the cinematography of Hollywood and that of Europe to appreciate precisely what V.K. Murthy achieved. Hollywood believed in kind of glamorization of the lead player. In a way, I'm sorry to say this, but to portray the female protagonist as an object of desire. You look at Vivian Leigh, or you look at Greta Garbo, or you look at Berlin Dietrich. The way the diffusers were dumped on the lens, and you know, the way their makeup was arranged, and the way their lighting was arranged for them. It all made to one end, you know, it was never rooted in reality. Whereas the European experience, especially after the expressionism and the neorealism of Italian neorealism of the 1940s, it was more towards getting it all down to the realistic. So V.K. Murthy was kind of caught in between the two. He started working somewhere in the 48-49. 48-49, that's when he went to Bombay. He was in the crossover phase between these two. And at that time, we had already done a film called Nicha Nagar with Chetan Anand. It was totally based on the European experience, and it was in fact a translation of lawyer debts. That film was a landmark film because that was the year, 1946, was the year in which Cannes Film Festival started. And this Indian film went on to win the highest award at Cannes, the Critics Award, and shared it with Brief Encounter of Sir David. So this was the kind of atmosphere in which V.K. Murthy makes his entry, and he chooses Bombay, the mainstream cinema of Bombay, as his workforce. Today, contemporary Indian cinematography is rooted in the work of two legendary masters, Subrata Mitra and V.K. Murthy. Subrata Mitra worked in the parallel cinema. He was the cinematographer of Satyajit Roy. And Satyajit Roy always doing the realistic cinema. He was doing what we familiarly call as parallel cinema. So Subrata chose the realistic school. He was not academically trained as V.K. was. He was a self-taught cameraman. But he chose the academic discipline. He worked in the realistic field. Whereas V.K. Murthy, having studied cinematography academically, went the other way, chose romanticism as his forte, and went into what we call as enhanced realism. You look at these two, and today, whatever we follow in Indian cinematography is a judicial mix of these two. The parallel cinema totally goes by Subrata's school of realistic photography, whereas the mainstream cinema combines both of them, especially more so of V.K. Murthy, because it roots itself in enhanced realism. You glamorize the heroine, but not to an extent that it is unbelievable. These are the basic high points of his work. Cinematography is all about the art of articulating the subliminal. This was for the first time brought to fore by V.K. Murthy. He made the image speak. What is in your mind, in the mind of what is going on inside the character is being spoken by the light, the composition. So the visual had a language. He started a new aesthetic, so to say, in Indian cinema. This was his greatest contribution to the art form. Till then, cinematography was considered as something which is to make things visible. That was a very functional work of photography. To make things visible on the screen is the job of photography. when V.K. Murthy arrived, he started making the image speak by itself, which was a very, very great achievement, considering that he was trying to do this in the mainstream cinema. That is an extraordinary adventure at that time. To quote an example, I mean, I think it takes a little bit more time to kind of dwell on it if we go on playing the clips again. So I would request you to recall from whatever you saw from Govind's documentary and recall those images. When you see, you will understand what I'm trying to say. I'll help you kind of articulate for yourself what I'm trying to say. If you look at the image of Kaagaz, if you remember that beam of light coming between the two, and then the two characters merge into the light. And then there is a shot, a dolly shot, in which the two faces are seen, and as the camera tracks, both of them become cutouts, black bodies against a white pitch black. If you remember that visual, it's a beautiful shot by itself. Leave that alone aside, but look at the inner meaning of the subtext. First of all, making these two characters merge within the light beam, VK is trying to say that this union is not possible in the physical world. This is only possible in the ethereal divine life, which is not going to be happening in this material. It's a premonition which he gives to the audience. At that point of time, audience will not know this union is not going to happen. But he has given a hint to you as a viewer. Look, this is what you get to see. And this goes to you subliminally. No, it is not a vocally spoken. That's why it stays in you inside. And it grows as the film grows along. Having said that, then he tracks the camera. You begin to see these two characters very visibly against each other, very closely in love, devoted to each other. But that is happening in the dark space of the studio. They can see each other and be with each other only in the dark corner of the world, exclusive to themselves. But the moment they are seen in the light of the outside world, they have to become adults. They become silent spectators to the world. And the world does not allow them to interact with each other. This is the kind of visual talk that Murthy engaged in. This is just one example of what he was trying to do. And this kind of articulation of the image, this kind of giving language to the visual, was something which was not done till then. Though V.K. himself was very fond of Falling Mysteries work. In fact, he was so fond of Falling Mysteries work that he kept on telling his colleagues in Bombay when he was an assistant that if only I could ever get to work with Falling Mysteries. He has seen a film called Amrapali of Falling Mysteries, and he loved the close-ups that Falling Mysteries had done. Falling Mysteries was a master of using diffusion, so he wanted to learn that technique. So eventually it so happened that one of his friends told him that you are supposed to go and meet Falling Mysteries in so studio. He is waiting for you. V.K. Murthy could not believe himself. And he went at the appointed time, and then at exactly at 10 o'clock in the morning, a man dressed in full white walked in, and he knew that he was Falling Mysteries. And he said that, are you Murthy? I said, yes. Then come to the floor. That's all that he said. He doesn't know how. Who told his name to Falling Mysteries, how he was called, but that's the way it was achieved. And right on the day one, Falling Mysteries told him, you are my 24th assistant, and you are the best. This was on day one. And that relationship continued. Till the time, Falling Mysteries left that studio and went over. He was supposed to Mughaliya. In fact, he was supposed to cinematographer. So he resigned from the studio and went over to make the film, but eventually that film did not happen. At that point, after V.K. Murthy said, what am I going to do in the studio without you? I came to learn under you and you are not there anymore, so I am also leaving the studio. So Falling Mysteries said, no, you stay on. I'll put you in a better place when the things happen. Till then you stay on here. And that's how VK stayed on in that studio. And eventually, Phalke Award referred him to Maharashtra Studios, and he went there. The second major film of the Guru Dutt VK Murthy combination we took at is Pyaasa. Pyaasa is a film which was so close to Murthy's heart. I remember him saying that he never revisited his films after it was screened. But Pyaasa. Pyaasa was the only film that he saw once again after it was complete. And again he saw it with us when we were studying the film with him. So, when that happened, in Pyaasa also, I want to draw your attention to this kind of language of the subliminal. We were trying to kind of see if we were kind of put too much meaning into what we were trying to see. In Pyaasa, we were constantly saying that this is based on the image of Christ. The protagonist has based his entire image on Christ, the suffering of Christ. Somewhere this was working in the visual field, but we did not know how it was being there. So we were not very sure. So we went on talking to VK about this. But he said that, no, I mean, we never had this kind of discussions or pre-arrangements as what we have these days. We used to go on the set and decide, you know, where to place the camera and then how to light up the scene, and you know, that's how we shot. There was never a very elaborate kind of discussion, pre-production plans, or storyboards, or things like that. And a very favorite word of VK was that, you know, he gave stunt mortality. So he used to call this as stunt mortality, you know, the kind of techniques that he used. He would make it so light, you know, he would never put that extra emphasis on I achieved something. It was never that. So if you remember, I don't know how many of you have seen Pyaasa in, you know, in close proximity. I urge the APU to kind of arrange a screening of Pyaasa and kind of have a long, lengthy discussion about the film itself. It is worth having a kind of a detailed analysis of that film. It's probably one of the finest films in that film. In that film, you saw that song, Hum Aapke Aankhon, is Dil Ko Basa Do. Once again, the same thing as what we saw in Kaagaz. Mala Sinha and Guru Dutt, the protagonist, they start dancing in the clouds. No? That scene begins when Guru Dutt meets Mala Sinha in the lift. Mala Sinha is wedded to the employer of Guru Dutt, and that happens. And he does not know that, you know, she is the wife of his boss. At that point of them, they meet, and when they exchange the looks, the lift wall dissolves, and they enter into this dream sequence. And through the song, if you notice, constantly Mala Sinha is saying that, if I don't care for you, and then what will you do? This is the gist of the song. Hum Aapke Aankhon Mein Dil Ko Basa Do. And she says, even if you go and faint, I won't even kind of fan you with my pillow of my sari. So this kind of thing. So she is constantly negating this kind of positivity of the interaction. And then in the end of the sequence, Guru Dutt is lost in the clouds, and she just climbs up the staircase and goes into the mirror. So the impossibility of the union between the two people who are in love, once again. And then again, you come back to the image of him singing at the doorway, Chala Lo Ise Bhook Dala Ve Duniya. That's towards the end of the film. At that point of time, what has happened is, he's the protagonist, he's the poet in the film. He's presumed to be dead, having committed suicide on the rail tracks. So this man who was trying to kind of eliminate this guy, gets his poems published and tries to celebrate him and kind of sell his books. So he arranges a function to celebrate the poet and the release of the function. And that's where dramatically Guru Dutt reappears. And when he comes in there, you see the shot, his face is in total darkness. I mean, just imagine this is in 1950s, and you have the protagonist of the film without being able to see his face on screen. Yeah? It is all darkness. It is just a shaft of light from the back, which is lighting up. Now, this kind of reality was something which was very, very difficult to do. Even today, I'm saying in 2014, you cannot photograph a lead protagonist like that. They simply say, check this cameraman out. Simple as that. You know, the next day, he did not come to the job. Very simple. So to do this was possible because Guru Dutt was with him all the way to do this. And he encouraged it. When even Guru Dutt, V.K. Murthy would kind of sometimes hesitate and say, change his lighting style, Guru Dutt would come back and say, nahi, kuch alag kar rahe ho tum yaar, tum tumhara karna, pehle jo karte the, wo karna. That's what it is. So this was the kind of chemistry between them. So and you look at that, and Guru Dutt rises up and he holds himself to the sill of the doorway. And then the camera comes back, cranes back, and sees the whole image in a long shot. And the upper terrace, the balcony is lit. The back of the balcony is lit with a lot of light. And Guru Dutt standing at the door is silhouetted with his arms. So much like a cross. These are the images that, you know, very subliminally put into your system. And then finally I got my confirmation. When I saw this one shot, when Rehman, who is the boss, he reads out the news of the poet's death to Mala Sinha, who is reading Life magazine. You know, her face is covered with the Life magazine, and the cover of the Life magazine is the Christ photograph. You know? So when I saw that, I said, okay, these people have worked on this and they don't want to share this secret. So, that's what I said. So this is a kind of subliminal language. Why I am saying all this is to impress upon you the fact that V.K. Murthy's contribution to Indian cinematography is so great that he allowed the camera to speak its own language, which is what cinematography is meant to be. And he stamped it time and again. And come to Tamas, you saw the shot of those women going to the Jallianwala Bagh well. Look at the kind of dramaticity in that. Look at the kind of, when you look at the whole, in fact, the shot follows a scene in which the women are praying inside the gurdwara. And she calls out for everybody to sacrifice themselves for the sake of what they believe. And with that fury, with that emotion, that this scene comes, and you know that it is not realistic. But look at the pace that it generates, you know, as they move across the smoking background. And you know, it's enthralling. So it is mood building and articulation of the subliminal and reading to the subtext. These were the main achievements of V.K. Murthy. I would like you to watch this song bit from John, Era Chandani, and see for yourself once again. This is the very first film that Guru Dutt became a combination for. The first shot was what you saw in Fazi. After that, this was the first film on which they collaborated. And this also, in the very first film, you see their chemistry working so beautifully. And you see this song, and then we'll talk about how the image takes control of the text. Oh, sorry. Thank you. MTA for our masterly works. We grabbed some stupid CD, DVD, which was available in the market. See, when this scene opens, what Devananda said is, you will come and meet. Actually, Maria is in love with this guy, but he's into wrong means. So she doesn't want to continue the relationship. And she says that unless you reform yourself, I'm not coming to meet. And Devananda says,
"Main janta hu ki tum aaoge, tum zarur aaoge."
And that's where the scene has ended, and this song begins. If you look at it, now where Devananda is, there is, everything is still. There is no wind, no this thing. Even his hair does not move. Even the leaf outside does not move. It is so still. And when it comes to Gita, they are not staying in the same area. They are slightly away from each other. He is in the boathouse actually, on the shore. And she is inside. And here, the storm breaks open the door and enters, as if the camera itself has become Devananda. The voice itself has become Deva. It breaks the door open and enters and drags her out by its magnetism. It is the camera which is doing it, the voice that is doing it. And when she comes out, and then the whole song goes on like that, and constantly interpolating between the storm and the calm of that man. And the storm here is symbolic of the storm in her heart. She wants to go, but she has to resist it. This is the storm that is brewing in her heart. And then, in the end, she finally yields. And what does Murthy do when she yields? She's climbing down the steps. She's getting down. She's de-elevating herself. From a superior position that she had taken, she caves in and she climbs down. And then the last shot you see, V.K. Murthy pulls out on the tray, looking at her from a top angle of view, saying that she has become a minuscule, right? She yielded to her. This is the articulation of the vision. Just imagine these were hardly 25, 26 year old kids doing this film. Both VK and Guru, they were hardly 26, 26 years at this, and they made this film. This was really, really hard. There's so much to speak about, but then the time is running short, so maybe we'll have some other session some other day. But there are two things which Mr. Chandan has given kind of throw a bit of light on. The second question he posed was, what were the innovations he introduced at the Kimo? Definitely, his constant word was, necessity is the mother of invention. I don't know how many thousand times he has said this in our conversation. Constantly, you think of a shot, how to achieve this, you have to invent a tool to do that. If it is not there, you have to invent it yourself. That's what he was always saying. And you remember, these people were working with very primitive equipment, considering from today's point of view. At that time, it was the advanced piece of equipment. This Mitchell camera was used to be so huge, and it has a huge motor on the side. And when I want to do a closer, I have to come nearly about 3 to 4 feet away from the artist. When I'm just 4 feet away from the artist, there is no place for me to put a light to look into her eye. So what V.K. Murthy does is, he constantly he could not sleep for more than a fortnight, wondering, how he will get over this problem, because Guru Dutt always wanted a big close-up of the hero. And there was no way to get this light inside. So V.K. One fine day, he saw one of his friends doing a painting by the easel light. He put an easel light on top of the board and he was doing some painting. Suddenly that idea struck him and he went and next day morning, the Coke used to be in cans those days. There was no bottle Coke at those days. So Coke cans, they were thrown in the dustbin. So he picked up two Coke cans and made a hole at the back and put a plug inside and put an ordinary household bulb into that. And he requested his friend to kind of borrow the clip, easel clip from him. Then he put it on the camera track and they said, okay, now put it on a dimmer and let us see if it works. sure it worked, and that's how we kind of derived clip like. And later we see this in Hollywood, another famous camera called Charles Clark. Then he uses this idea. He makes a ring light around the lens using the same technique. Yeah. So they format. So similarly with Subrata Mitra also. And Subrata Mitra, I had brought that scene from Charulata, which we just happened to glimpse, just to show what realistic lighting is all about. It feels as if there has been no light which has been there. That is what realism is all about. The room looks like this, the room looks like this. If you see all the president's men of Gordon Willis, it is exactly like this. Because it is a press that is at work. So he has to show that Watergate scandal happening in the press. So he shoots in this kind of light, which is every light to the photographic light and shoots like this. So realism is all about that. So this was one clip light, and then huge close-ups once again. And Murthy was always bothered about how comfortable his light meant to be. He constantly used to say, one of my greatest achievements, Bhaskar, was that I never had an accident in my entire career. None of my life was suffering. Except that one boy whom I had warned that, you know, not to sleep on the catwalk, and he did not deserve me. That will always be enough with me, you know, that tragedy. But for that, I always used to take care that, you know, they are well protected, they are well taken care of all the time. Because they are the people who are working. This was the kind of concern he had for his colleagues. So he always wanted a light from the top. You know, the heroine is here. When you are doing it close up, you need a light really about, you know, 5 feet above. So it is very difficult to get a catwalk to work at that level. So he used to make what is called as a goda. A goda is an ice stand actually, of about 6 feet high. And on top of that, the light stand will be there. So it was very difficult for the light man to reach on top of that. So what he did was, he built a special ladder around the light stand itself. And it became so famous, it was called as Murthy Ka Goda. So especially even in Madras, it was kind of came into use, it was called as Murthy Ka Goda. And of course, you saw Vakthinaya Pyaasa Sika. This was a song which was so innovative. When Guru Dutt said this is what he wants to do inside the closed studio space, he wants to get this light to kind of light up these characters. And the divine beam of light, that is the essential stuff of the whole thing. And what is this divine beam of light? It is a sun's rays. The sun's ray is always a parallel beam. They are not like our tungsten light. You know, we have got a specific distance to move, so we always spread out like this in a cone. But sunlight is coming from such a far distance, it is a parallel beam. So this thing was very clear in his mind. I want a parallel beam. But how to get that, we did not know. He kept on wondering for 3-4 days how to go about it. And suddenly he saw a light man during lunch hour playing with his makeup mirror. He was trying to throw sunlight into the dark studio space. Just playing with that light. Catch the light in the mirror and throw it into the light. And suddenly that idea stuck to VK, and he said that, went and told Guru, mujhe do bade mirror chahiye. And go shot on the right. So he just went and brought those huge mirrors and opened the balcony of the studio floor and put one mirror outside and reflected sunlight onto another mirror on the catwalk. Catwalk is a kind of a ring like this, below which the set is there. The lights are placed on this to throw light onto wherever you want. So he, from the gallery, he got the sunlight through a mirror, put one more mirror here and positioned it wherever he wanted. That's how he got the beam of light to work. There are no artificial lights in that scene. And it was really magical because it was achieved without a special effects happening. It was achieved live on the camera. So it was one of the, in fact, the day it happened, these two instances I just recall when I closed my session. Fardun Irani, who was a senior cameraman to VK Murthy at that point of time, he was also working in the same studio. And the practice used to be that, you know, I shoot today and I send it for processing, and tomorrow morning before I shoot, I see the result of what I have shot. And then I resume the shoot for the next day. Retaking, if something has gone wrong the previous day, I'll redo that shot. That's the idea. That's why it is called as a rush. It is not a full fully prepared print, but a rushed print made for an emergency, just to look at it. It's not graded or anything. It is not fine tuned. So the next day, when after having done this shot, when VK entered the studio floor, Fardood Irani just climbed down from the projection room and hugged VK Murthy and said that, Kamal Kadhyar. And VK Murthy did not know what had happened, what Fardood Irani had seen. He did not even know that, you know, Fardood had seen this work. Because generally, nobody used to see other person's work. But Fardood Irani could not withhold his curiosity. And he may have gone and seen this. And he was so generous. He came and kind of, you know, shared this wonderful news with VK. And then it became a kind of history in Indian cinema, that shot. And look at the kind of constant kind of support that divinity provided to VK. As Ms. Umara said, the kind of friend that Srinivasan was, who made possible for VK to join SJP and to continue his education. But for that, VK would not have joined the incident, we would not have got VK. And then, like a cameraman like Bhatra, whom you see in that shot where the crane is sitting with Guru, then Vaidharaman is there, she comes into the shot, and then she says, I came to return the port to you, and then she says, Bas kya mamla. That is VK Bhatra, who allowed VK Murthy to do that shot. So these are the kind of people who helped VK Murthy gain that stage that he was meant to achieve. And significant contribution to world cinema. I mean, what more can be there than positioning a film like Pyaasa as an all-time great in the history of world cinema? And to kind of give Indian cinema a new look in the world, a new status in the world, when we are being looked down upon as kind of mere photographics. He brought credibility to the art of cinema in the mainstream. That was his greatest achievement. I think, I have shared whatever little I could in the limited time frame that I had. Thank you so much for listening to me, and I once again invite you all to the BFest Festival. We'll meet again there and be with us. Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you, Bhaskar. Thank you, Mark. You have got to mention this whole thing. Co-conspirator, Sara, we've been planning this for months and went back to as well. One other quick thing to mention, Umarav's book, Biography of V K Murthy, which won the Sahib Bibi Award, is here. So one of few copies for us to buy if you're interested. It's 250 rupees. It's your chance. And don't say no to Kanda, you can always gift it to a Kanda speaking friend. It's the guy, sales page, that's your software.